Hello, statisticians. Mr. Young Saber here from Skew the Script. Amidst the growing concerns about climate change, there's still a large number of people who doubt whether climate change is real. Today, we're going to do a statistical analysis of one of the most cited works of climate change skepticism, and we're going to explore whether its arguments debunk the phenomenon of climate change. Let's skew it. Today's lessons on inference for matched pairs. In 2004, the book State of Fear was published. In the book, eco-terrorists plot mass murder for the sake of propping up their false theory of global warming. It's fiction, but has tons of graphs of real data, footnotes to scientific articles, and a 20-page bibliography. When it came out, it was a bestseller. The author of the book is Michael Crichton. He wrote Jurassic Park, created the TV series ER, and he earned an MD, medical doctor, but decided not to pursue medicine long-term. His book became so popular that he was even invited to testify before Congress. A senator who chaired the Environment and Public Works Committee said of Crichton, "I think I've read most of his books. I think I've read them all. I enjoyed most State of Fear and made it required reading for this committee." Today, the book is still one of the most cited, if not the single most cited work in climate change skeptic circles. So for today's key analysis, we're going to ask, does the data in State of Fear disprove climate change? If you'd like to follow along using guided notes, you can print them out from our website. So first, let's talk about identifying matched pairs data. There's one chapter in State of Fear called To Punta Arenas. Punta Arenas is a city very far south in South America near Antarctica. Here's a quote from that chapter talking about this graph. "It's the record from the weather station at Punta Arenas, near here. It's the closest city to Antarctica in the world." He tapped the chart and laughed. "There is your global warming." And you can see here this chart, which is printed in the book, which shows that temperatures seem to be declining over time in Punta Arenas. So when evaluating data, we should always first look at the source. So checking the source, this is from the GISS dataset at NASA. The GISS dataset is a surface temperature station dataset that is compiled by NASA, and it's a very good source. Here's Punta Arenas, and it has one weather station there. But in this data set, there are also more than 7,500 stations across the world that collect temperature data across the year. And climate patterns vary a lot by location. So instead of looking at just one location, let's also ask, what is the average trend across many of these stations? If we're talking about global climate change, we should be looking across the globe at all the data we have in various areas of the Earth. So collecting the data kind of looks like this. We can look at the typical temperature between 1901 and 1950, the typical temperature between 1951 and 2000, and we can find the difference between those temperatures. So in this case, the difference was a decrease by about 0.076 of a degree. So temperatures, it turns out, tended to cool down during the 1900s in Punta Arenas. But what about in the rest of the world? So what we did was we randomly sampled 32 pairs of longitude and latitude coordinates. So 32 pairs randomly of longitudes and latitudes across the world. And then we found the nearest temperature station for each of those sets of coordinates to get our random sample. We get two temperature measurements per station, one for the early part of the 1900s, one for the later part of the 1900s, finding the typical temperature in those times. And then we find the differences within each station. So among each station, we're finding the difference from the earlier to the later. This data has a matched pairs structure. What that means is we have each individual station with two measurements. Each station, each has two separate measurements. And we're going to find the differences within each individual, within each station. We're not finding the average differences across all stations. We're looking at the differences for each station. And it's useful because we're controlling for variation in weather patterns between stations. By calculating those differences within each station, we're controlling for some variation between them. We can plot those temperature differences on a number line like this. So note that zero, no difference between late 1900s and early 1900s, signifies no difference, no typical change in temperature. And in some of the data, in some of the stations, the temperature tended to cool. But in a lot of the stations, most of the stations, the temperatures seem to actually have warmed. There's a positive difference from the later to the earlier. So there's warming at most stations. Punta Arenas showed a negative, a decrease in temperatures by 0.076 of a degree, but it is not what we call a typical case. It's cooling when most stations showed warming, a positive difference in temperature over time. So is Punta Arenas representative of climate patterns across the world? Definitely not, as we can see from this data. And most would say that Michael Crichton, when he wrote this, cherry-picked this data, found a station that was relatively unusual compared to the rest, and showed that data rather than other ones that he could have shown. So this is what we call BS, bad statistics, as we know. So as you can see here, the vast majority of the globe has shown warming from 1884 to 2019. And what in this graph, which is made by NASA, was one of the few pockets of cooling that we see across the globe? Punta Arenas, in the south of South America. So that's how you cherry pick the data. You look for the place that's unusual and you visualize that place. So how will we get a more representative measure of a typical change in temperature across the world? Well, we should find the mean of all these differences. So if we find the mean of these differences, we get a value of 0.35 degrees Celsius. So that means that the stations on average showed a positive difference, or i.e. warming on average. So let's test this. Is the average temperature significantly greater than zero? So much greater than zero that it would be unusual to say that difference happened by chance alone. There's true warming happening. So to do this, we can make a match pairs T interval. So the cool thing about match pairs is that it's the same as one sample inference. We're finding a single mean of differences. This is a mean of differences. And that mean, the mean of the differences in our sample, was 0.35 degrees Celsius. So let's investigate if we got an unusually warm sample or if the Earth is truly warming on average based on our sample. So we're going to construct and interpret a 95% confidence interval for the true global average temperature difference based on our sample. And we're going to determine if we have statistically convincing evidence of true global warming on average. Do we think that there's true warming if we were to measure everywhere across the world based on our sample? And is your interval consistent with your answer to part B? So first, let's do that interval. And as per usual, we're going to use the four steps of inference to organize our work: state, plan, do, conclude. So for state, we're going to state the parameter we're estimating and the confidence level. We're estimating the true mean of differences in station temperatures at 95% confidence. Name your inference method. So we're going to calculate a one sample T interval for the mean of the differences, or mu D, if all conditions are met. And here are our conditions. So one, random. The sample of 32 stations was conducted randomly, as we got random latitudes and associated them with stations. 10%. So we have to have our sample size be less than 10% of the population size. So 32 stations is less than 10% of all the stations in the whole data set, 7,520. That is true if you do the math out. And then finally, normal slash large sample size. 32 is greater than 30. So that means the sample size is large enough for us to say, yes, we can model this with our T distribution. So let's go ahead and perform calculations. And if you look at the raw data, we have a sample mean differences of 0.35 and a sample standard deviation about 0.296. So we can plug those values into our calculators. And here are the steps for doing that in a TI-84 to do a one sample T interval for the mean of the differences. It's the same sort of procedure you're gonna do for a one sample T interval normally, and we get our output. So I'm going to copy down the commands I use in the calculator, and I'm going to write down my final interval, 0.24 to 0.46. For the conclusion, we should always interpret our result with context. This means that we're 95% confident the interval from 0.24 to 0.46 degrees Celsius captures the true average change in global temperatures from the early to the late 1900s. So we think that this interval captures the true average temperature change. So now let's determine if we have statistically convincing evidence of global warming on average. For that, we're going to use a slightly different procedure. We're going to use a t-test. So first, we're going to state the hypothesis significance level, and we're going to define our parameters. So our hypothesis is that, one, the null, nothing's interesting. There's no mean difference. Temperature has not changed over time. The mu of the difference, the mean of the difference is a zero, versus the alternative, where we're seeing if we have convincing evidence of that there's been a positive change in temperatures over time. On average, the differences have been positive, where mu D is the true mean of the differences across the whole Earth. So let's plan. Name your inference method, check conditions. Now we're going to do a one sample T test for the mean of the differences. And the conditions are already met. It's the same conditions as the confidence interval. And then we're going to go and perform our calculations. And we're going to report the test statistic and the p-value. So this time we're going to plug in our sample data into the menus for a t-test rather than a t-interval. And here's how to do that on a TI-84 calculator. When you plug everything in, and here's my writing showing the calculator command that I use with all parameters labeled, I get a t-value of 6.69 and a p-value of less than 0.00001. So a very small p-value. So then we're going to conclude based on our p-value and test statistic. And here's our conclusions template. So we know that because our p-value is very small, less than 0.0001, it's less than our alpha level, so we're going to reject the null. Turns out we do have convincing evidence the true global average temperature rose in the 1900s because it's significantly different from zero, no change. We saw a significant change in temperatures over time. So is the interval we got before consistent with the result we got from our test? Well, the interval was 0.24 to 0.46. And the test result was that we rejected the null and were convinced of the alternative that the mean of the difference is greater than zero. These are consistent because the interval of plausible values, my confidence interval, is entirely above zero. So we have convincing evidence that there's been a positive change in temperature because all our plausible values are above zero. They're all positive. We are convinced that there's been a positive change in temperatures. In other words, we do have convincing evidence of warming. So now let's discuss. In State of Fear, it's clear that Crichton cherry-picked Punta Arenas, which showed climate cooling amidst a globe that mostly showed warming. Similarly, scientific reviews have shown that his other arguments have tended to have substantial flaws in that book. And the large majority of climate scientists report that climate change is real and currently happening. However, climate change is complex. And the speed and severity of climate change, as well as our ability to limit and adapt to it, is less certain. Now, scientists have time to study these things that are a bit more uncertain, but policymakers and us, in the meantime, have to make choices. So our discussion question is this. If you were a policymaker, given some of this uncertainty in the future with climate change, how would you prioritize climate change among other issues? What factors, risks, costs, and benefits would you consider? Explain at a general level and explain your thinking. That's it for today, statisticians. We look forward to seeing you in class.